Hi, I'm Ireen, and I'm obsessed with peatlands. Thought I might just get straight to the point. I'm obsessed with their colours, their smells, their carbon capture abilities, how they can literally and metaphorically suck you in, and how they are in many ways a true in-between. I'm obsessed with everything about them. And yes, obsessed is pretty strong wording, but I think it's the only appropriate word here to describe my relationship to them. In fact, I think we should all be obsessed with peatlands. And I'll tell you why. I dedicate a pretty significant chunk of my time pushing for peatland protection and appreciation. And I found that this is especially important because many people don't even know what peatlands are. Who here does? What about bogs, fens, mires, swamps? Yeah, bet the last one rings a bell. Do you know, a mere 2 years ago, if someone had asked me about peatlands, I probably wouldn't have had a clue. Or maybe I would have pictured a swamp from the Shrek movies. A dirty, brown, somewhat gloomy, and pretty unattractive space. So how did I get from an absolute peat nobody to a full-on peat fanatic who would love to live in Shrek Swamp, has literally organized an entire peat festival, and will probably drop peatlands, such as the one picture behind me, into pretty much any conversation that I have? Well, towards the end of 2019, two of my friends, Bethany and Frankie, went to an action camp in Germany called Free the Soil. I had gotten to know them both from university, and we had been doing various climate projects together. We went to protest, organized gatherings, got involved with actions, and I think it would be fair to say that we gradually got pretty neck deep into the climate movement. Now, at this action camp, Bethany and Frankie went on a peatland excursion. And as they waded into the soggy soils of the bog, a peat scientist named Jan Peters, yeah, that's really his name, shared some mind-boggling facts about the power of peat. Peat is formed as dead plant material becomes submerged by water. Through decomposing in still water, the water becomes depleted of oxygen. And what remains is an anoxic mix of water and partially decomposed matter, in a sort of pickled state. This matter is called peat. And since decomposition stops as oxygen runs out, peat accumulates a huge amount of carbon. Peat forms layer upon layer, sometimes over the span of more than 10,000 years. To illustrate the scope of this, peatlands, though only covering 3% of the world's land surface, store 30% of all terrestrial carbon. All forests in the entire world combined can't even level that. And some people estimate that there is more carbon locked in peat moss than any other plant on Earth. But carbon trapping isn't even their only superpower. Peatlands host a range of unique plant and animal species which like to have their feet wet, such as cattails, curlew birds, the funky carnivoric sundew plants, and specialized peat mosses. Peatlands are a water sponge, preventing both floods and drought, but also acting as a natural water filtering system. Peatlands offer a quiet and sheltered breeding space for many migratory birds. And to go even further, on a philosophical level, peatlands are enchanting, acting as a threshold space and in between. They are as much a process defined by the formation of peat as a concrete thing. They're not quite water, not quite land, not quite dead, not quite alive, not quite then, and not quite now. Their distinct character has played an important literary, artistic, and cultural role throughout history. So really, peatlands have it all. However, peatlands don't have it easy right now. Peatlands are being drained and destroyed on a large scale. For example, in Germany, peatlands are being drained to let cows graze on them. In the Baltic states, peat is being dug up for the export of potting soil. And in Indonesia, peatlands are being destroyed to make space for palm oil farms. Now, you might be thinking, all right, thanks for the story, but why should I care? Well, since peatlands store so much carbon, the effects of peatlands on the climate are enormous. Peatland destruction is responsible for 5% of the annual human-induced CO2 emissions. That is more than the entire aviation and shopping industry together. Peatlands are such a potent carbon sink when intact, and such a potent carbon source when degraded. Bethany called me up after the action camp to share what happened. And as you can maybe imagine, I was shocked. How is it possible that we, as young people, who had essentially committed our lives to the climate movement, had never been told about this? A strong sense of duty dawned on all of us. We have to do something about the peat. And then, on the bus ride back from the action camp, while people were still talking about the excursion, a friend jokingly pitched the name RE-PEAT. Of course, you can't waste such a great name. So at that point, there was no going back. RE-PEAT was born. And as a newly found peatland collective, we started cracking our brains on this paradox. How is it possible that an ecosystem so beautiful, equipped with so many vital features, is written off so easily? And we came up with the following explanation. Peatlands are often categorized as wastelands, useless, putrid spaces full of annoying midgets and not much else. And once you've identified something as useless, as worthless, you have essentially gotten yourself a license for unapologetic destruction. This is the same excuse that has been used multiple times before to erase entire ecosystems and communities. On top of that, through a capitalist lens, a drained bog equals money, and a wet bog equals no money. So, 1 + 1 = 2, and you got yourself a broken bog. Now, I do want to stress that this is merely a rule of thumb, not a universal truth. The stories of peatlands are layered. Yes, the capitalist logic is a big driver behind peatland destruction, but greed is not always the underlying reason. For example, in the Netherlands, drainage used to happen rather to simply have more land surface area. And in Ireland, peat burning provided fuel sovereignty from the colonizing Brits. Peatlands are mushy places. But the conclusion here is a solid paradox. If we wish to re-peat the peat, we have to dig deep and radically change peat perception. So the question that we started asking ourselves was, how do we change this peat logic around? How do we dismantle and debunk the myth of the wasteland and build a new meaning which actually represents all the superpowers of the peat? In essence, how do we shift the peatland paradigm? My idea? We will have to reimagine the peatland. Reimagining peatlands means valuing peatlands not for the monetary profit that they may generate, but for simply existing in all their fullness and generosity. I believe that reimagining is a crucial step towards changing our current climate catastrophe-inducing system. Reimagining is a process of becoming, of unlearning adulthood, of becoming unproductive and playful once again. For instance, as a kid, when you see a tree, you see a hiding spot, a playground, a home for birds, a building material. But as an adult, you just see a tree. Adulting has started to mean getting sucked into the productivity machine, being told to always seek efficiency and being sold the idea of purchasable happiness. Yet, if we truly want to change our system, we will have to open our minds to alternatives and radically change peat perception. With reimagining, we take the time to just stand still for a second and observe. Look closely at the little things around you that maybe you stopped paying attention to. Use your senses of sound, taste, and smell. Use your hands to explore the textures. Start to reimagine your surroundings, your daily reality. Now, I know that this all sounds very abstract, so I want to invite you into a small reimagining exercise. I'm going to play a short sound fragment, and I want you to close your eyes and listen carefully to it. Maybe you just want to count the amount of different animals that you hear. Maybe you can visualize the sounds that these sounds come, the smells that these sounds come from. Or maybe you can completely travel into the peatland and feel your feet soaking into the mud. Now, did that sound like a wasteland to you? At RE-PEAT, alongside being obsessed with peatlands, we use peatlands as a microcosm of the world, a tool for understanding reality. Because this talk is not only about reimagining peatlands as entities, it's about relearning how we can integrate our existence with them in a regenerative way. It's about going beyond the ecosystem services and the business cases and really start thinking of more symbiotic alternatives where both the ecological and the human needs are met. And this won't mean putting a fence around the land and letting it heal, because drained peatlands actually require human rewetting activity. There's already many different practices which can be practiced indefinitely on healthy peatlands, which have been deployed historically by local and indigenous communities. It's important to honor and pay close attention to this knowledge as we reimagine these landscapes. At the same time, there's a lot of experiments currently happening with regards to sustainable agriculture on wet peatlands. For example, the farming of cattails as an isolation material, or sustainable peat moss farming to replace the peat in compost. Reimagining is not about getting into a pressure cooker and inventing a highly futuristic idea for a solution to all of our problems. Rather, it's a shift in mindset that you can practice in your daily life and incorporate into anything that you do. Think back to the soundscape that we listened to earlier. What did you notice? Maybe you noticed the birds, while your neighbor paid attention to the rustling of the grasses or the falling of the rain. When I'm finished, why don't you ask him? Bringing all these perspectives together produces a much richer image of a peatland than anyone could have imagined by themselves. In other words, none of us will be able to shift the peatland paradigm alone. It requires a long process of broad engagement and continuous collaboration. Because reimagining is a never-ending practice. Every exercise of reimagining is a step in expanding your toolbox of reimaginative skills. We started today with the peatlands, one of the most overlooked yet super-powered ecosystems, as well as a fascinating microcosm for understanding the world at large. As a next step, can you try to reimagine forests, mountains, rivers? Reimagine conservation as a whole? Reimagine a future beyond the exploitation of the natural world. Go as big or as small as you wish. It is evident that the peatland paradigm has to shift. The climate crisis is one of the most pressing issues of our time. And if we wish to do something about that, we have to take care of our peatlands. The real challenge in front of us is envisioning an alternative to the ever-destructive business as usual, to visualize a future which we do want to live in. And radical, playful reimagining will be fundamental to this process. So join me on this creative, reimaginative journey. And next time you see a peatland, take the time to absorb it. Notice the colors, the sounds, the smells. Imagine the sponge-like features, the water filtering systems, and the funky plants. And maybe you too will feel the superpowers of the peat and become a little bit obsessed with them.